somehow it's not Trump and the actual Nazis who are being like Hitler. It's the liberals who are being like Hitler.
Yeah.
It's like, no.
They called Obama Hitler.
You know, because...
Oh, yeah, they called Obama Hitler. I saw the pictures, all the, you know, with the little mustache and everything. I'm pleased.
Well, you know, it's a very obvious association because most people, when you hear Nazi, the first thing you think is free health care.
They say national socialists, right?
Yeah.
But you know what has always blown me away, and I worked with a black dude who told me, he said, I don't believe in you shouldn't have free health care and you shouldn't have free education. I said, so you're saying that a person should... go to school, get out with $100,000 wrapped around his fucking neck, and never get the hell. But a person from another country gets free education in their country and then comes over here and kicks your ass because 14% of the companies that are started here in the United States are by immigrants. People from other countries.
Because they believe in the American dream.
They come over here and
they're little companies that you never would have heard of, like stuff like Google.
Yeah. Okay, and that's the thing I'm sitting there saying. You know, you're keep talking about. You haven't heard the American dream in a long time, have you? You haven't heard about that. What about the white picket fence? There's no more June Cleavers and the beaver.
You don't even hear about climate change anymore. You don't hear about anything important.
Hasn't been any beaver in a long time.
It's all surface soap opera. It's a soap opera, is what it is.
Which you know, and every time certain groups start to grow and they start to make things happen. You know, you say, oh, well, they're taking your job. No, corporations decided want to pay you, which I've always talked about that we have a battle between capitalism and labor. If you do, and the people, if you do your history, there's always been a battle between capitalism and labor. Hell, Rockefeller didn't want to pay people. I mean, they used to send squads out to beat people. I mean, you had children were picking berries at 5 years old. They had to stop that. We had to fight to get 8 hours. For you to work 8 hours a day, people had to die.
It used to be 16 hours, and then it was 10 hours, and then it was 8 hours. There was no such thing as a break. This is labor is fought for people to have anything at all. So if your arm gets cut off, you know, you can get something.
And so I looked
at... It's never been the capitalists or the employers.
I looked at, when they said minimum wage. Minimum wage was not meant for you to make gobs of money. It wasn't meant to take care of a family of four. It was for a teenager. I had that job. You had that job. That job was made so I could have a summer job in when I got out of school or when, you know, for those of us had to work and go to school in high school to help pay rent, you know, when our parents couldn't afford it, but you worked your way through and then you had a job. And even back then, McDonald's and Burger King would send you to college, be a manager and run your own Burger King. They had programs.
Like,
and you had stuff like that. But they took all that away. You took away, you took shop
KB
out
Toys,
of high school.
KB and Toys used to have that.
You took shop where a guy could go. You took vocation out of high school where a kid could go to school, learn a trade. You had nurses that were 18 years old. You walked out of school and you were an RN at 18 if you didn't want to go to high school. That stuff is now private colleges. Everything's been privatized. And then you wonder... You took it away, and you say, okay, now you got a 40-year-old man working as a minimum wage guy trying to take care of a family, and you say, well, fuck that, we're not going to pay him $15 an hour. Well, what are you going to do? If you say we're going to make everything technology, actually, you didn't bring us along well enough so we could be on top of the technology as we should have, because I don't think we were there.
The stuff in education is a lot more insidious than you guys know. It's deeper roots of like bureaucracy and corruption. There's a lot of things going on that most people don't know about unless that's their business.
Right. Oh yeah, I learned some things.
In that business, I learned
some
things. You find out some stuff.
I was working as a telemark academic tutoring company. They were funded through No Child Left Behind to provide tutoring to low income families at schools that were at risk.
No Child Left Behind really didn't fund much at all. That was like pretend.
There were real programs. I mean, I worked for them. I was a tutor for one. I was a telemarketer for one that were providing these tutoring services. Those were actual, and they would all go out there, and all the various tutoring companies would fight over
Because they're trying to privatize.
Students.
It was their step into privatization.
But the kids, the families didn't have to pay for the tutoring. It was completely government-funded tutoring.
Ours is all free, too, from school.
And so... I worked for them, and I would call these families on these lists for the low-performing schools. And some of the schools, The parents were like, oh, my kid doesn't need tutoring for basic studies because the school my kid goes to, and this would be in like East LA, like inner city area, they're just a vocational school. So basically this child at 14, 15 is already going to just be a hairdresser. No offense to hair. Or they're already just going to be trained to be a carpenter. They have no chance.
There are a lot of jobs in construction. The average construction guy today is 28 years old. He used to be 20, 22. They can't find guys to do that type of work anymore because you know why? They don't train them like they used to. They can't find those. You used to bring them up young, so gave them a work ethic, and they also were able to, if they wanted to go on to college or if they just wanted to learn a trade and go off to trade school, they could do that. Those programs really don't exist. Although, you'll find this, at Juvenile Hall, they have an adult living program that pays for a juvenile to go to college.
Wow.
He can come out. All he needs is a C average. They will also give our tax dollars will pay for them to go to college, as well as give them an apartment and help them get a car. If they choose to turn their lives around, it's called independent living, and they will help them.
You heard it here first. Yeah. Get into a life of crime early while you can still qualify for programs like this. Yeah. And you're setting yourself up for the future. I don't think it's such a bad thing to, you know, have these vocational programs. And, you know, yeah, someone gets slotted into life early. You're going to be a hairdresser. There are people who, you know, and this is going to sound like a diss. It's not. But there are people who are sort of resigned to a certain life.
But they could end up owning their own hair salon.
Hairdressers make more than teachers. Come on. So did at before when they had the garbage workers, whatever, you know.
I know, but
they used to make good money.
And it really bothered me, though, that this school was like a fully, completely Latino school. Like in an area where it's all minorities.
I understand that, but, you know, we were talking before the show about the coal miners in Virginia, you know, that... my granddaddy had black lung disease, my daddy had black lung disease, and damn it, I'm going to go get black lung disease.
Yeah.
If you are setting yourself up to, you know, very early on to go on a specific path in life, you know, better something that serves the public without killing you outright.
I had a friend of mine whose father grew up in the South, and he was a musician, and he said his dad told his mom when they got married, my kids will not be raised in the South, and he moved them to the North, to Philly. He said, no, my kids will not be raised now because of what he was going through. So he went to break that. You have to, whoever the parent is, they have to have that thought to change the generational curse that they see and say, not my kids.
Well,
and make that move.
You know, people, when they're talking about their family history, it is always said with pride that I was the first person to go to college. Nobody is sitting there, you know, well, I guess they are, but nobody's taking, outside of those circles, is taking the person seriously who brags about being a fifth generation coal miner while they're bitching of the hazards of coal mining.
Right.
It's one of those things, and I don't take this as Ayn Rand objectivist bullshit, but, you know, there are situations where you should really make the effort to pull yourself up by the bootstraps, to try and change your situation. And this is, you know, this is where government programs like welfare are supposed to come in.
Right.
And granted, there are people who abuse that system, just as there are people, let's say, like, I don't know, the president,
right,
who abuses the system from the other end by, you know, running a casino into the ground and then turning that into a 20-year tax dodge. Granted, there are people on both sides of the system that work it to their advantage.
You look at opioids.
But the thing is, when you've got programs like welfare and other government assistance programs, like the thing you were talking about,
contemporary living.
Yes. These are there to give someone a tool to help them get out and to help them improve their life so that they can improve the lives of those around them.
Well, you look at the opioid situation. Trump says, "Oh, it's an emergency. We got to, you know, We got to go out and help the people on with the opioid thing. Well, what happened to crack, motherfucker? You didn't see the people on crack? You didn't go out and try to help all the crack folks? No, you know what you did? You locked their asses up, because if you were doing crack cocaine instead of powder cocaine, you got more time. Also, if you got caught with a bag of weed, you went to jail. But now, because the opioid situation has made it to white suburbia, your ass is like, oh, wait a minute. We got to go and take care of that situation.
Well, but in traditional Republican fashion, much like, you know, the 9/11 hijackers were mostly from Saudi Arabia That's and right. trained in Afghanistan. So, of course, we went and attacked Iraq.
Right.
Because we have a problem, Jeffrey Beauregard Sessions III wants to crack down on weed. You know, yeah. it's the same.
Well,
same
it is
sort
a
of principle.
Gateway drug, so, yeah. I mean...
Yeah, you know, I knew a guy in the 90s who had a gateway computer, and since then, he's just been buying bigger and faster computers. it's a bad way to start, kids.
Yeah, and you know, they looked at that situation, and now, I mean, it's out of control. Well, heroin has never stopped being out of control. Heroin has always been, and it killed... I had a friend of mine said, yeah, you know, heroin's back. I said, yeah, it killed... Back then, it didn't kill your ass today.
It's inspiring, you know, Trump's inspiring me to try to maybe use heroin, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'll jump off a cliff, no.
Go fentanyl, man. That's the way to do it.
Yeah. Still blown away that Prince took fentanyl. Jesus. Like, most probably, more.
Well, it all has to do with the painkillers, though. That's why it's, like, so insidious that people start and they just have, like, an innocent athletic injury or something. Yeah. They're just getting old and their back hurts, and next thing you know, they're hooked on heroin.
But fentanyl is 50 times more powerful than heroin. And to be, if he was already taking that, I'm sitting there going, dude, who's handing you this shit? Okay, I mean, even the drug dealer himself is going, man, you sure you want this shit? You know, why would you do this? And whatever doctor it was that gave it to him, yeah, they should arrest his ass too, because, like, dude, you should not be handing someone fentanyl when it's this powerful. I don't care how much pain, you know, either get the hip surgery or something, but he would not... get the surgery, and he would rather take the drug, and they found him.
Mm-hmm. So, David, how about that sheriff's pardon? That racist sheriff. Oh, he's awful.
Yeah. There is a lot of awfulness about Joe Arpaio. I have a personal grudge against the man, but that's a story for another
show.
Did
he make you wear pink underwear?
Well, he didn't make me wear pink underwear, but no, I've never served time in Arizona or elsewhere.
He made
Yeah. He
and Charles Barkley.
Someone
Charles
pointed
Barkley.
Out this week on Twitter that Trump finished his week by saying that some Nazis are good people, and finished his week by giving a pardon to a guy who bragged about building concentration camps in the desert.
Oh my God!
Yeah.
But Arpaio, you know, I sent a tweet to our president the other day, trying to remind him that in January. He did swear to uphold the Constitution rather than shit on it.
Yeah.
He apparently had forgotten that by the end of this week. For those not familiar, Sheriff Joe Arpaio was a renegade sheriff in Arizona who was told by the federal courts to stop racially profiling Latinos, that you can't pull over someone just because they're, you know, where they fall on the Pantone scale and ask them for their papers. That's un-American. And I think we would all agree. We've got two Latinos, a black guy and a Jew. I think, you know, maybe we're biased because we are on the racial side of things. But I think we can all agree that randomly pulling over people because of the way they look and asking them for their papers, that is a bad thing.
Yeah, I would think that, you know, when people, and I've had that discussion with people, and I said, you know, we would never do, you know, people are shocked that people are that folks, I said, this is not new.
This is not new at all.
The Civil Rights Bill
this
was signed, I'm 52,
yes.
Be 53 next month. It's 53 years old That's that we right. were allowed to vote. Okay, these things are not old.
And voter suppression is still going strong.
I have to say, I am so disappointed as a millennial. I remember growing up in the 90s, and like in my elementary school and middle school, whatnot, they would really beat us over the head with Martin Luther King movies and documentaries and all this stuff about civil rights. And it was like, yay, now we're all like equal and holding hands. And I was like, sweet. Like, that was what it was like growing up in the 90s. You're like, cool, who would be a racist? That's like a dinosaur. That's dumb. And so I grew up and I thought everything was fine. And I am so shocked. I have been so shocked the past like few years.
About the whole middle of the United States.
I was like, what? Well, I thought that they were just like super Christian in the middle. And then it turns out like this, that thing, the last 50 years like didn't even happen over there.